Welcome. Good morning. Good morning. How happy are we to be here? Come on. Yes, you should be clapping with joy. It's been 18 long months having to do my job in my basement. So I'm very, very happy to be out of my basement and on the stage at Cumanzales once again. It's been 2 years since we've done this in person. So I'm really thrilled to be here with you all. My name's Alyssa Hammond. I am the director of the Undergraduate Career Development Team for the Pulsifer Career Development Center here at Bentley. And I'm delighted to be with you for the next 45 minutes. And we're gonna have some fun. You guys up for some fun? All right, if you were here to see a dry, boring presentation about career development, you can leave now because it's not happening. All right, we're gonna have some fun this morning. And you're also going to learn about what your students either have been up to, my senior parents, your junior parents, my junior and sophomore parents, and for my first year parents, what your first years are going to be up to in the spring. Sound good? All right, so at Bentley, we have a career education suite of courses that I'm very proud to say is an award-winning set of courses. The National Association of Colleges and Employers gave us the Career Services Excellence Award for our CDI classes, which makes me very proud. So in 2012, we started with our CDI 101 course, which is for our first years. And it's iterated over the years. And now we have transformed it from career development to career design. Because in this course, it is a career development toolkit course where your students learn how to build the important tools that they need in order to find a job, right? Which are life skills. But they also are being asked the question, why? Why do they want to do what they want to do? How many of you knew at age 17 or 18 years old what you wanted to do? Anybody? Yeah. And those of you that did, are you still doing it now? One lonely person, two people, okay, three people out of this group are still doing what they thought they were going to be doing at 18, 19 years old. But the reality is that our students don't really know what they want to do, or they have ideas, but they don't necessarily know if those ideas should be put into practice for themselves. Do those ideas match up with what they're really good at naturally and also what they're interested in? And so at Bentley, this is not about getting a job. We know that we can help our students get jobs, but it's about getting the right one, right? And so we start that conversation in our first year in our CDI 101 course. And then as our students move into their sophomore year, we have our CDI 201 course, which was started in 2016. And recently we've revamped it. So now this course is strictly for students who are undecided in major or in career path. And this course does deep dive assessments. Your first years will take the Strengths Finder, the Clifton Strengths Finder, as part of CDI 101 for free. And they will know what their top five strengths are. And so what we do is we take that information and we start to drill down into it in terms of, well, how does this help them, this self-awareness in terms of what they're really good at, not even knowing how or why. But also they get to take the strong interest inventory, which helps them understand what their interests are and how those interests align with career paths and occupations. And then we take it to the next level in terms of, so where does that bring you in terms of major? Okay, so that's where our CDI 201 course is. And now we've opened it to juniors because even as a junior, some juniors have declared and then are questioning. So we're allowing them to kind of go back in time and take this course to either confirm that they're in their correct major or maybe they can switch based on their changing interests. And then we have our CDI 301 courses. So for my junior and senior parents, your students should have been enrolled in 301 or should be enrolled in 301. And 301 is our advanced career design course. We have 8 different 301 courses for every major here at Bentley. And why do we have 8 different ones? Because recruiting changes as their major is declared. Some majors are recruited early, all at once. They're looking at technical skills, their case interviews they have to prepare for. Other majors don't get recruited until they're graduating. And then it begs the question, what should they be doing until that time, right? And some majors don't care about GPA, others care greatly. So things the paths diverge tremendously when it comes to career pathing based on major. So our sophomores, juniors, and seniors who know exactly what they want to do, they should be taking or have taken 301, which is an asynchronous course, which allows them to do it on their own whenever they want, which is great. So it gives a lot of accessibility and equity in terms of the ability to take this class. The first two are in person, 301 can be done online at the student's discretion. So if your students are not registered for their 301s, make sure that they get registered. Okay, so anyway, so what are we talking about today? Well, guess what? You guys get to take class today. Are you ready? And we're doing 80 style because I have a junior in college myself. So I think that we're all pretty much in the know about the 80s. Am I right? Is it not one of the best decades? Yes, it was. So what we're going to do today is we are going to take class, and I am going to walk you through one of the classes that your students will take in CDI 101 or have taken in CDI 101, and you're going to learn something along the way. So today's topic is taking the work out of networking. So what's networking got to do with it? Well, I would like to show you two data sets from our class of 2020, okay? So we do surveys 6 months after graduation to find out what happened to our students, where they landed, what they're doing, and how they got their jobs. So here on this side, you'll see that there was 98% employment for this particular major. And this is the path to employment. And you'll see personal networking is at the top at 32%. Does anybody want to guess what major this is? Finance? Anybody else? You would be correct. Finance. Okay. So students in finance need to understand that networking is one of the most important things that they need to be doing and should be doing in order to land a position when they graduate, followed closely by all the other things that they need to do. So as you can see, it's like a third, a third, a third, and then some more, right? So it's not just one thing that they should be doing. There's a number of things that they should be doing, but network is incredibly important. This is not just about applying for a job, interviewing, and calling it a day, okay? Now, the second side, 100% employment, path to networking, path to career is through networking as well, 42%. What major is this, do you think? Marketing. Any other guesses? Accounting. This is management. So management majors, significant number of them got their positions through networking as well. So that's why networking is such an important part of our class. And we devote an entire class and a half to networking because a lot of students aren't comfortable, right? Talking to strangers. So I think we all know this to be true, that 80% at minimum of the jobs that are out there are unknown. They are not posted, right? So you know about them how? You know about them through other people, right? So you have to get to know those other people in order to be able to identify those opportunities. So your ability to get a job drastically increases the larger your network is. And this applies to all jobs at any level, not just in college, right? So I have three people that are in the same career path that they wanted when they started. I want to know, does anybody still do what they did when they got out of college? The same job in the same company? Okay. So the vast majority, you've moved at least once, right? Well, the average number of jobs that a person will have before they retire is 12. I know, it's crazy. And now people are moving every 2 to 3 years. And we're seeing that changing happening even more with COVID, right? Because people are changing their jobs because they want different quality of life, they want flexibility, et cetera. So this is happening all the time. Changing your job is happening all the time. So networking is a lifetime skill. This is something that you need to know how to do all the time, right? Because if you're not meeting with people and knowing people, and you're ready to move to the next phase, right? That next job, and you never know when that's going to happen, you don't have a network, right? To rely on. So this is for all ages and stages. So this is for you all to be working on, as well as helping your students along the way. Okay, so contact theory. Does anybody know what contact theory is? Contact theory. All right, well, I'm gonna play a little clip for you to demonstrate contact theory. You probably know this little movie.
Adams, here. Adam Lee.
Here.
Adamowski. Adamson.
Here.
Adler.
Here.
Anderson. Anderson.
Here.
Bueller. 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 Bueller.
He's sick. My best friend's sister's boyfriend's brother's girlfriend heard from this guy who knows this kid is going with the girl who saw Ferris pass out at 31 Flavors last night. I guess it's pretty serious.
Thank you, Simone.
No problem whatsoever.
Fry.
All right. So Simone is in the know. How is Simone in the know? Because of contact theory. All right. So contact theory is a theory that was developed by a psychologist named Stanley Milgram in the 60s. And basically what he discovered through his research is that we're all connected to one another through six other people, all of us. So when he was doing his research, he managed to connect an Aborigine in the Amazon to an Eskimo in the Arctic or Antarctic. I always get those two confused. And by virtue of all of us being in this room together, we are now connected. And it's gotten even closer, contact theory, because of the internet, right? Because of LinkedIn, social media. So we're all now actually connected by 4.92. And I don't know how a person can be a 0.92, but that's what the math tells us. So we're all connected. Everyone's connected to everyone else. But the goal is, how do we find those people, right? What are those six people that connect us together? So thank you, Simone, for demonstrating contact theory. Now we know what happened to Ferris. So in the 90s, this fine gentleman became part of the culture of 6 degrees of separation. Who is this fine gentleman? Please tell me you know who he is. Thank you. Because when I'm in class, I ask and I get dead silence. They're like, who is that? Like, are you serious? Please. Thank you very much for knowing who this is. So this is Kevin Bacon. And in the 90s, because Kevin seemed to be in every single movie out there, the game was made about him. And now there's this game that's been going on for years, decades now, called 6 Degrees of Kevin Bacon. And believe it or not, I am a weird savant when it comes to this game. So if you give me the name of an actor or an actress, I can connect them to Kevin Bacon within 6 degrees. Anybody want to give me a try? Keanu Reeves. Awesome. Keanu Reeves was in Parenthood with Diane Wiest, and Diane Wiest was in Footloose with Kevin Bacon. Anyone else? Celine Dion. Was she in a movie is the question. Well, her songs were. Will you give me that? All right, Celine Dion. Well, her music obviously was in Titanic. Leo DiCaprio was in Titanic. Leo DiCaprio was in What's Eating Gilbert Grape with Johnny Depp. And Johnny Depp was in Black Mass with Kevin Bacon. Thank you once again. I could do this all day. Could do it all day long. One more. It's been 2 years since I've been able to do this with people. One more. Ooh, Bobcat Goldthwait. He was in that horrible clown movie, but he was also in a Police Academy movie, wasn't he? Yes, he was, yes. All right, he was in Police Academy, probably like 500, with Steve Guttenberg, right? Steve Guttenberg was in Three Men and a Baby with, Ted Danson. Ted Danson was in, I just saw him in Cousins. but now I'm getting away from things. Hold on a minute. Give me a minute. Do I want to do Lori Bridges? Hold on. I'm backing up a second in my mental Rolodex. Steve Guttenberg was in Cocoon too. I could go there. No, I'm going to go back. I'm going back. Okay. Here it is. All right. Here it is. Ready? That was a good one. Love it. Here it is. All right. You ready? Okay. Bobcat Goldthwait was in Police Academy with Steve Guttenberg. Steve Guttenberg was in Three Men and a Baby with Nancy Travers. Nancy Travers was in So I Married an Axe Murderer with Mike Myers. Mike Myers was in Austin Powers with Rob Lowe. Rob Lowe was in The Outsiders with Tom Cruise, and Tom Cruise was in A Few Good Men with Kevin Bacon. All right. All right. See, I told you we were going to have some fun today. Anyway, the reason I do this is because I want our students to be able to get to their Kevin Bacons. And the only way they can do it is by talking to people, right? So I might meet you, sir. And I might say to you, sir, what do you do? May I ask? Equity research. Okay. I'm not interested in equity research, but I am interested in marketing. So I know you. My dad knows you. And my dad says, well, you know what? Talk to this fellow. What's your name?
Darren.
Darren. Talk to Darren. Darren, where do you work?
Fidelity.
Sweet. All right. So I reach out to you and I say, my dad suggested that I reach out to you and I would love to learn more about Fidelity. And you say,
let's have a coffee.
Right. Let's talk. Right. Are you going to say no to the friend, to the son of a, or the daughter of a friend? Absolutely not. Right. So we have coffee and we talk and I talk to you about what you do and about Fidelity and you're telling me about equity, whatever. And I'm like, yeah, I really don't care about that. But I do know that Fidelity might need somebody in marketing. So I say to you, you know what? I'm really loving our conversation, but I'm really interested in marketing. And Darren, do you know anybody in marketing?
No, but I can see everyone all over the company, so I probably help you out.
Thank you. All right. And then I'm on my way. So Darren finds someone for me to talk to. And I say, Darren suggested I reach out to you. And they say, oh, well, any friend or colleague of Darren's is a friend or colleague of mine. Let's talk. And then I get closer and closer to my Kevin Bacon. So if I want to work in Fidelity in marketing, then you've gotten me there through maybe 2 or 3 degrees. Okay. So that's what we want your students to be doing. And it's not hard. Darren, you're a very nice man.
The hard part is getting your kids
to do it. Exactly. The hard part is getting them to do it. And we're going to get there. Okay. We're going to get there. All right. So here's how we get there. So the first thing that we do is we talk about how everyone's connected, right? We're all connected. Like I said, by virtue of being in this room, now I'm connected to Darren and all of his contacts. So Darren, if you hit me up on LinkedIn, I got 3,000, have at it. Then we talk about these 6 degrees, right? And getting, basically using people to get to the people that we really want to and need to know. And when your student says to you, I don't know anybody, that's a lie, right? Of course they know people. They have friends, they have family, they have teachers, they have professors, they have maybe coworkers, old bosses. They know lots of people. And they think that those people aren't the people, but they are the people, right? Because all of their friends have you. Friends have parents. Right? I can't tell you how many times I've had conversations with students and I said, have you done your networking? Have you started? And they were like, no. And then they'll come back and they'll say, you know what? I said, we have to start telling people what you want to do because then they might know people. And they came back to me and said, you know what? I told my roommate who I lived with for 3 years what I wanted to do. And I found out that their parents are in the business. I was like, are you kidding me? Really? You live with this person for 3 years and you probably know the parents and yet you never told them what you wanted to do. Well, I never thought to have that conversation. It's like, you have to have the conversation. Just say it. This is what I want to do. They'll probably say, oh, let me help you. Right? So their network is right beneath, it's right all around them. So it's up to you to remind them of that, right? That they have a network and that it's okay to tap into them. It's okay to ask. Now, when it comes to networking, what are the most important degrees? It's really not the first degree, right? It's really not Darren. It's really who Darren knows, right? So it's really the second, third, fourth degrees that are the most powerful, right? That's where we need to get our students, is to those third and fourth degree connections. So that way they're with the right people at the right time, okay? And when it comes to networking, it's not about asking for a job, and we're gonna talk about that in a second. It's about getting that information, right? It's about setting up that relationship. So that way, when the job does become available, they're there, right? They're top of mind when the job comes up because they've taken the opportunity to get to know that person. And what are they doing when they're doing that? They're impressing you, right? Wow, that was really great that they took it upon themselves to want to talk to me. That's impressive, right? And so at the end of the day, you know, we tell them to start with their first degrees, right? In order to get to their wish, right? To their Kevin Bacons, to the people that they really, really want to know at the end of the day. All right. So let's talk about dating for a second, shall we? Let's just change topics altogether, or are we? Okay. So I love it how you sat in the front row. What's your name, sir?
Todd.
Hi, Todd. So I see you're with your lovely wife.
Yeah.
Okay. So Todd, let's pretend that you're single.
Oh yeah, all
right. Okay, all right. All right, and you're in college. Okay, so anyway, Todd, you and I are set up on a blind date. I know. And we get together and we are sitting at a table and we're talking. And then about maybe 10 minutes in, I look at you and I say, Todd, would you marry me? It's okay what you're going to say. How would you respond to that? And it's completely, you'll not offend me in the slightest, whatever your response would be.
No.
No.
Not today.
Not today. That's very polite. Would you want to leave?
No.
No, that's a first. Usually I get, yes, I'd excuse myself to go to the bathroom and then I'd never come back. That's usually what I get. Thank you, Todd, for being a gentleman and not leaving me. Although you probably would never talk to me again. Okay, so when it comes to networking, when you meet somebody for that first time, asking them for a job is like asking them for marriage on the first date, right? Don't you think? I don't know you, and yet you're asking me for something really big, a big commitment. I'm not in a position for that to happen, right? Now let's reset this table. We meet. We have a lovely date. And then at the end, I say to you, Todd, I had a lovely time. Would you like to get together again? What would your response be? Todd would say yes. And then we get together again. We have a lovely time. We get to know each other. We get together again. We get together again. And then maybe we'll go steady. Maybe, right? Or maybe it goes nowhere. But we have a relationship, right? So at some point after we've gotten to know each other well, which requires what? Time. It requires effort. It requires seeing each other and talking to each other on a semi-regular basis in order to get to that place of asking for marriage, right? Or asking for that job. So when I talk to my students about networking, I tell them, think about it like you're dating. Okay, guess what? And the good news is that you don't have to be monogamous. This is the only time I don't want you to be monogamous is when you're networking, when you're dating. I want you dating a lot of people, okay? I want you out there playing the field and really talking to people. And it can't just be one event, because in a relationship, is a relationship built on one interaction? It is not, right? It's nice to talk to you, but if they never talk to you again, and then they come back 2 years later and they're like, hey, remember me? What are you gonna say? No. Who are you? Oh, yeah, we never talked again. Why would I help you now, right? So we want to treat business networking like dating. Focus on compatibility and approach it with pragmatism and not high expectations, okay? It's about relationship building and getting to know people. And how do we do this? We do this through informational meetings, right? Asking Darren and Todd for a coffee talk, right? A chat. Can I have 20 minutes of your time to ask you some questions? How many of you, if you were asked for an informational meeting from a student, would say no? Exactly. How many would say yes? Even if you didn't know them, thank you. Exactly. It's just a conversation. There's nothing heavy about it. It's just for them to learn. And we tell them, this is your opportunity to really figure it out. Like, there's a lot of stuff on the internet, right? You can learn a lot online. There's no question. However, will you know the real truth online about a company, about a job? Not necessarily. But you will if you talk to a human being. Why? Because they're not selling you on anything. This is not a job interview where they're shining it on. Oh, we're awesome. Oh, no, you won't work 80 hours a week. Oh, yeah, you'll get promoted in a year and a half. This is not an interview. This is an informational interview, an informational meeting. So you can ask the person, so how many hours a week do you work? And they'll be like, oh my God, I work at least 90 hours a week. I work at least 12 hours a day. What about flexibility? Yeah. They say that doesn't exist, right? You can ask them, what are the skills that are required? What do I need to do to get this job? What classes do I need to take? What major should I go for? What activities should I be doing? What's a GPA? What's the projection of mobility? You can ask all those things during this conversation and get the truth. And that's the most important thing. So not only are you getting this really valuable information, you're getting the truth. And then what's happening? You're setting up your network because you're getting to know these people and they're becoming part of your network. But it requires work and you have to be diligent. And I'm not suggesting to your students that they stalk people, you know, but I do tell them you have to touch base with these people at least 4 times a year. That's not a lot. Once a season, wish them a happy holidays at Christmas. Happy spring, happy baseball season, whatever in the spring. Happy 4th of July, happy football season. 4, that's all you need. And if you hit it off, even more, right? If you really hit it off, then maybe they'll become a mentor, which is even better, or a sponsor, which is a whole other conversation. So it's all about relationship building, right? And developing that meaningful network. So that way the job may not be here now, but the job will be there eventually, right? Students come to me all the time and say, oh, I can't, they're not hiring. And I say to them this, they're not hiring today, but they will hire tomorrow or next month or next year. And are you gonna do the work to be in the right position? So when that job does become available, you know about it? It's up to you. It's up to you. Are you gonna do the work? We hope so. Oh, hi, Sheila. How can we get recordings of today's seminar? I'll let you know. I have no idea right now, but I will let you know. All right, so it all leads to the job prospects, right? And remember, your students are going to be changing their jobs a lot in their lifetimes, and so may you. So that network is key. All right, so some of you may recognize these two characters. Any fans of Stranger Things? Yes. I can't wait for it to come back. So this is Steve and Dusty, and they're out monster hunting. That's all you really need to know. And so they're out monster hunting, but while they're monster hunting, they're also talking about girls. And if you don't know Stranger Things, it's set in the 80s, okay? So they're having this conversation, and Dusty had asked Steve about his hair, because he's got this fabulous flowing head of hair. And Steve's just like ignoring him. Until this moment.
Fabergé. What? It's Fabergé Organics. Use the shampoo and the conditioner, and when your hair's damp, it's not wet, okay? When it's damp.
Damp.
You do 4 puffs of the Farrah Fawcett spray.
Farrah Fawcett spray?
Yeah. Farrah Fawcett, you tell anyone I just told you that, and your ass is grass, you're dead, Henderson. You understand?
Yep.
Okay.
Okay, I had to show that. When I saw that in the episode, I thought, oh, this is great, because this totally goes with my theme. So Fabergé Organic Shampoo. Anybody remember that back in the day? Yes, back row. I see you. Yes, we all wanted Farrah hair back then. I could never have it, but I always wanted it, right? So Fabergé Organic Shampoo. This was a very famous commercial back in the day with the very fabulous Heather Locklear.
When I first tried Fabergé Organic Shampoo with pure wheat germ oil and honey, it was so good I told two friends about it, and they told two friends. And so on.
Okay. So, yeah, I know. Wow, right? What a blast from the past. I love it. So when I talk to my students about networking, I also tell them about, you know, we've been talking about contact theory, right? We've been talking about how we set up these meetings. We talk about what we're talking about. And then the follow-up, right? How we have to keep talking to people and following up with them. But guess what? There's a secret thing that every student should do every time they meet with somebody. Every time. Do you know what that one thing is? The most important question that they need to ask during an informational meeting. What do you think it might be? Yes, exactly. Do you know someone else who I can talk to? Right? So think about it. I tell my students, because they always say to me, oh, this is so overwhelming. I can't do it. It's too much. I say, listen, pace yourself. This is what you should do. This is your assignment. This is your goal. You're going to come up with a list of people. Come up with a list as long as you can make it. And you're going to start at the top. And you're going to call 5 people a week, just 5. And the goal is to schedule just one informational meeting, just one. If you get more, great, but you just need one. And you set up that meeting and you talk to that person. At the end of that conversation, you ask them, do you know anybody else who would be helpful for me to talk to? And they give you just one person. And then you call that person and you say, Darren suggested that I reach out to you. And then you talk to that person. And then at the end of the conversation, you ask, do you know anybody who I could talk to? And then they give you another person. So if you set up 5 informational interviews, or no, actually one, let's just talk about one informational interview a week for 14 weeks, that's a semester, and you ask for one referral from each of those people, that's 28? I'm not good at math. 28 people, right? And then you ask those 14 people for another referral, then we're tripling. And then you ask those people for another referral, we're quadrupling. So you could conceivably only talk to 14 people on your initial list and talk to up to 50 people without even trying because you're asking for the referral. And they told two friends and they told two friends and so on and so on and so on. You want to be the Fabergé Organic Shampoo. You want to be Kevin Bacon, okay? You want this. So you ask for the referrals. It's critical. And it also takes the fear out of doing this, right? Because the question was begged, well, how do I get my student to do this? They're afraid, they're nervous, they're self-conscious. Well, they won't be if they're being given warm contacts, which is what we're talking about here. They're getting warm contacts, they're getting the referrals. And so asking someone and saying, this person told me to call you, they're not going to say no. In fact, they're going to say, yes, let's talk. And away you go. And all you're doing is having conversations, right? Nothing bad's happening, except if I ask them to marry them, but that's not gonna happen, right? All right, good, I'm on time, thank goodness. Okay, so be a stranger, ask for referrals. Really, really important. Okay, so now it's time for you to be the matchmaker for your own students. Now, usually we would have a handout given to you, but instead what I would like you to do right now is take out your phones. Take out your phones and open up a note. And if you're on LinkedIn, open up LinkedIn or just think about who you know. And this is what we would do in class, is we would stop and we would do an exercise. So your exercise is that I want you to write down 5 people you know who you think would be good for your student to set up an informational interview with. Think about five people. It could be relatives, friends, colleagues, anybody, anybody. Remember, they don't have to have a correct connection to what your child wants to do. Just somebody who would be willing to talk to them. And we would give you like 3 minutes to do this. So I'm going to give you a minute and a half because we're running out of time, but think about it and jot down some names. And if you can't come up with anybody at the moment, take some time later over the weekend to find some people for your student to talk to. And then say to them, here are people for you to talk to. They won't bite. Do it for yourself. And guess what? If they don't know what they want to do, it's an even better conversation, right? So regardless of whether they know what they want to do or they don't know what they want to do, they need to start talking to people to help them figure it out and get the jobs eventually, or maybe even so now, right? Sometimes a conversation will lead to an immediate internship or a job opportunity, right? I just lost, somebody just quit on me. Literally in my office, someone quit on me. So if someone came to me and was like, hey, I'm interested in what you're doing, I would look at them seriously for that job, right? All right, so that's what we would do in class. So while you're thinking about that, I'll start talking a little bit about how we help your students outside of the classroom in terms of networking. So this is obviously pre-COVID. This is the goal, is to get back to this. So we're gonna talk pre-COVID and then we're gonna talk now. So typically in the normal world, we would have about 140 companies coming to the Fall Career Fair and about 1500 students in attendance, and we do it in the arena. And I want to acknowledge my colleague, Jen Thibodeau, who's over there. Everybody should give her a big round of applause because that woman is the one that puts our career fairs together. So, and she is by herself right now, as a matter of fact, doing it. So Jen Thibodeau is our wonderful colleague in employer relations and recruiting and puts our career fairs together, and they are monumental affairs for sure. And she also runs our on-campus interview program. So a very important person on our team. We have networking nights for our majors, for dedicated majors. And we have about 120 plus companies that are attending those four networking events. And this is just in the fall. And then about 1,250 students attend our career community programs in just August and September, just in 2 months. That's how many students are attending these programs. And these are not including career fairs or recruiting events. And in the fall of 2020, which was last fall when everything was virtual, we still had three virtual career fairs. We still had over 100 employers, over 600 students attended, and we had 45 virtual career programs. So, and we're doing more and more. And now we have a system called Handshake, which I think has tripled our events, Jen, if I'm not mistaken. So your students now have three times as many events with employers to engage with. And all they need to do is go on Handshake and they can go and they can look at all the different events that are happening. And that's also where all of our job postings are. And I believe our job postings doubled. Our job postings also doubled in Handshake. Okay, so that's where your students need to be and they need to be attending. And believe it or not, virtual attendance is almost better than in person. Why do you think that would be? It's like a strange upside to virtual, but why do you think attending a program virtually is actually better for a student? Think about it. When a student goes to a career fair, sure they have a name tag, but they're in a sea of hundreds of people, right? They have about 2 minutes to say hello and then they have to move on. Whereas online, they're meeting one-on-one, their name is on the screen, right? And they're meeting with them for 10 minutes. Just with them by themselves, nobody looking over their shoulder, waiting for them to move on. When they attend a program, a career community program, their face is on the screen with their names for an hour. So an employer sees that, right? And so when they see the resume come through, they're like, oh yeah, I remember seeing that student at my program. Fantastic, right? So the virtual programs actually, I think, are even better for our students than the in-person ones, if you think about it. you know, especially with this mask situation, right? There's only so much we can gauge from the nose up, you know, from the nose up, if you will. So this is all on Career Edge. This is our website, careeredge.bentley.edu. You can also get to it on the Bentley homepage. And I encourage all of you to take a look. You can also subscribe to newsletters. You can create accounts and you can see what your students are seeing every day, every week. We have customized curated emails that go out to your students at least twice a week, if not more, with all of this information, including blog posts, videos, resources that are specialized and specific to your students' interests and affinity and identity as well. So there's a lot of great contact and a lot of great things happening here. So how can you help? Well, we have checklists on our website on Career Edge for every single class year. And as you can see on these checklists, it's what your students should be doing and what you should be doing, okay? So this tells you, right, one page tells you exactly what your students should be doing at any moment in time and what you should be doing to help them, okay? Now, the thing about job searching is this. Did anybody have somebody, I mean, outside of like a family business, did anybody come to you and give you a job, like literally like hand it to you without you doing anything? Does that happen? Did anybody like walk up to you and be like, I have a magic drawer and here's your job? Did anybody have to work to get their job? Did anybody have to apply, interview? Yeah, right? Okay, nobody did that for you, right? Nobody did that for you. You did that. Your parents did not do that for you, right? They didn't write your, they might've written your resume or cover letter, but they definitely didn't interview for you and they definitely don't do the job, right? Okay. So in this scenario, parents, you are like me. We are the coaches, okay? We're coaches. We can guide and educate and encourage and give resources and information until the cows come home. But can we play your students' game? No, we cannot. They have to play their game. This is their game to win or lose. And by the way, we don't want them to play not to lose. We want them to play to win. And what happens when you play? Do you win it all the time? No, there's gonna be failures. And that's a good thing because that helps them develop resilience. You're not gonna get it all the time. You're gonna apply to 100 jobs and get no interviews. And you know what you do? You keep going. You don't give up, you keep going. And by the way, if that's all you're doing, shouldn't you be doing more, right? Shouldn't we be networking? Shouldn't we be doing other things along the way to help our chances? So it's up to us to help your students get in their game, keep their head in the game. High School Musical, keep your head in the game. Keep your head in the game. Yes, I'm a High School Musical fan. I admit it proudly. I went to the premiere of the third movie, cried. We are coaches and they are the players, okay? And they can't win unless they practice and they play. They can't win unless they practice and they play. So we have to make sure that they are practicing and that they are playing. And this is how we can do it. So for first year students, the good news and the great news. The good news is that they don't need to be doing anything right now for this stuff. We want them to get acclimated in school. I'm sorry, I'm going over time, but I don't care. They have to get acclimated in school. They need to do well, right? That's the most important thing. GPA, as well as getting active and really understanding and becoming really good citizens of Bentley and really enjoying their time here. In November, first year parents, make sure that your child is registering for CDI 101. It only comes around once. It's only offered in the spring of their first year. 98% of our students take it voluntarily. This is not mandatory. It is free. It does not count for any credit. So it's not a creditless class, but it does go on the transcript and employers know it and see it and are looking for it. They're looking for a pass on CDI 101, but it is free. And as I said, your student will also get to take the StrengthsFinder assessment for free when they take this course, okay? Sophomore parents, if your child is undecided, they need to take 201. It's only offered in the fall, but we do offer it in three different sessions. So there are still two more sessions coming up in October and November. It's once a week in class. Your students can still register. And if they can't, they call me and I'll get them added. Sophomores, juniors, and seniors, if you haven't enrolled in your 301s, you need to. Because as I said, this is on-demand career coaching based for your major. All the resources that you need to advance your resumes, your cover letters, how to learn how to interview, what types of interviews you need to be doing and preparing for, how to negotiate salary, how to accept, all those things are covered in 301. You have the whole semester to take it. 201 and 301, also creditless courses, no grades, no homework, only attendance for 201. And 301 is just do it when you need it. Okay. So I'm out of time, but I'm going to ask for questions anyway. So does anyone have any questions for me? Yes. It is online. So CDI 301 is online. So that way all students can take it. They can do it at midnight on a Sunday night. They could do it at 5 o'clock in the morning. I doubt your children will be up at 5 o'clock in the morning, but that way they can take it whenever they need it. And they can also use the modules as they need it. Okay. And our coaches are the instructors for all of these courses. So they have someone in our office who is instructing them along the way and creating all these materials because they're all experts in these areas. Yeah. And CDI 301 is offered in both semesters. Okay. And we also offer one specializing in consulting because we have a ton of students that are interested in consulting. Any other questions? Yeah. So it's mixed. So the large career fairs are definitely virtual. We're trying to do some smaller career community events in person. It's difficult because some employers aren't able to come on campus. So for the fall, the decision was made just to keep things virtual for now with the hope that things will change and we'll be able to do more and more on-campus events. Yep. All right, I think I'm getting plugged because there's someone coming up behind me. So I want to thank you so much for your time today. I hope you learned something. I hope you had a little fun along the way. And I want to say, welcome back, Falcon parents. Have a great time this weekend.